Good evening, everybody. Bonsoir. We're going to start in a few minutes. Just want to.
Bonsoir tout le monde. On va commencer dans quelques instants. Je vais faire quelques petites annonces.
Et les. Ah, je m'excuse. Il y a deux entrées-sorties de la salle. Il y a l'entrée principale où vous êtes rentré. Il y a une autre sortie à votre gauche. Si vous cherchez les toilettes, vous pouvez sortir ou par l'entrée principale ou par la sortie à votre gauche. So there are two main entrance and exits into the room. There's the main entrance.
L'entrée principale, vous avez rentré, bien sûr. Il y a une autre sortie, si vous cherchez les toilettes. Vous pouvez passer par l'entrée principale, tourner à la droite et les toilettes sont là. Ou si vous sortez de l'entrée à la gauche, ils sont justement là. On va commencer dans quelques minutes.
That's what I had. I took a picture of those lumberjacks. That was amazing. Yeah, that's a great initiative.
Is it real?
I just want to say hi. I'm Toby. Just called by to see you.
Oh, hi. I'm Abba Jackson.
Yeah, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Hello, Roslyn.
Hi, Dan. I'll be doing a little introductory words, and then I look forward to the presentation.
Thank you. No, I think I'm just going to use the clock. I'm going to try to take advantage of when I see you.
Okay. And we have this thing here just to
Oh, not standing there. You guys told us to sit.
No, but you can stand.
Aiming for 15,
can
but I know
sit?
Why.
Oh, no, because there was a whole discussion that we were going to present from sitting.
Yeah, but you're actually standing. Is that a problem?
Well, none of us know that, so okay. I just want to make that announcement.
You're standing for the presentation. Yeah, there was a... We don't have the wireless mic.
Okay. And it's, well, the podium also meant blocks, like that whole room couldn't see me, so...
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
to put notes higher.
On peut le mettre là-bas. So... Okay. Good evening, everybody. Bonsoir, tout le monde.
Bonsoir, tout le monde. J'aimerais vous souhaiter la bienvenue à notre première labo d'urbanisme de 2020. Alors, bonne année à tout le monde.
De vous voir ici à notre premier labo d'urbanisme de l'année 2020. Alors, bonne année à tout le monde. And we're going to get started. There's still some people coming in, but we're going to get started.
On va commencer à l'heure quand même, même que pour ceux qui sont en écoute en direct. Tony Nussbaum, le PDG de la Commission Capitale Nationale.
Merci Stan. Good evening everybody.
Bonsoir tout le monde. On est très content de vous accueillir ce soir sur le territoire non cédé algonquin et Anishinaabe.
De l'urbanisme, je vous souhaite la bienvenue. Bienvenue aussi aux personnes qui ont déjà assisté à une séance de labo. We of course thank you for your loyalty.
On vous remercie de votre fidélité. Ce soir, c'est quand même sur un sujet très, très important pour la CCN. Nous allons discuter le rôle du changement climatique et les répercussions sur la planification urbaniste. Nous savons que les villes jouent un rôle fort important. Beaucoup d'émissions de gaz à effet de serre émanent de nos villes, sont générées dans nos centres urbains grâce au transport et au chauffage et climatisation des bâtiments. Alors, lorsqu'on parle du changement climatique, il y a beaucoup de rapports entre les villes et les émissions. Je vais prendre quelques instants pour vous parler un peu de notre approche à la CCN, la Commission de la Capitale Nationale. On y pense en fonction de l'adaptation. On y pense depuis 2005. On a publié une étude enquêtée sur le changement climatique auprès du tourisme dans la Capitale Nationale. Festival des tulipes, la saison de ski dans les Gatineaux. Et le patinage,
nous savons tous, devient de plus en plus difficile à prévoir au fil des ans. We also think about adaptation when we have floods.
Et l'adaptation aussi lorsqu'il y a des inondations, comme on a vu en 2019 et 2017, aussi lorsqu'on veut établir des sentiers, par exemple, ou des pistes cyclables. Alors, nous suivons de très près l'évolution des statistiques et des rapports et projections climatiques et météorologiques. Très important pour l'adaptation. Mais on ne peut pas laisser ça tout simplement à l'adaptation. Il faut aussi essayer de trouver des moyens d'atténuer un peu les effets du changement climatique. On pense peut-être dans le sens commercial, le bâtiment, on peut essayer de construire des bâtiments net zéro émission carbone. Il y a diverses façons qu'on pourrait traiter de l'atténuation, mitiger les résultats. Et on veut jouer un rôle de leadership pour réduire les émissions de gaz à effet de serre. Nous avons un fabuleux réseau de transport en commun, par exemple, et comment peut-on encourager d'autres moyens et mécanismes de transport moins polluants. Alors, je voulais tout simplement indiquer que c'est un intérêt premier de la CCN. Nous avons premièrement trois conférenciers très intéressants ce soir. Eva Jackson, à ma droite, directrice qui est responsable de la ICLEI Canada sur la durabilité, l'engagement public.
Et internationaux en tant que gestionnaire de projets en consultant. Et elle a dirigé l'élaboration du guide Changing Climate, Changing Communities en collaborant avec beaucoup de gens de divers domaines et en mettant à profit leurs connaissances. So Eva's going to talk a little bit about.
Elle va nous parler des projections de haut niveau, si vous voulez, pour la capitale nationale. On va nous parler des risques aussi.
Gosselin, qui est chercheur affilié au Centre de recherche de CHU d'Équipe Québec et coordinateur du programme santé au sein du groupe Impact et Adaptation de Renos. Dr. Gosselin is the author of more than 200...
Et l'auteur de 200 livres, articles, chroniques sur la santé environnementale pour le public et pour les spécialistes.
Systémique, dont les habitués du labo d'urbanisme ont déjà entendu parler, puisque nous avons déjà abordé ce sujet. That was, I think, last year, but of course, a subject that is.
Cependant, c'est un sujet qui est très important. À sa droite, à mon extrême gauche, Dan Stanley, directeur de recherche à l'Institut pour les changements catastrophique. Il est auteur aussi de plusieurs articles sur les risques d'inondation, gestion de risques, changement climatique et adaptation. Il va nous parler de la vulnérabilité des codes de construction et qu'est-ce qu'on fait pour minimiser ou éliminer même ces risques. Sans plus en dire, je vais céder immédiatement la parole à Eva. Merci énormément et merci beaucoup de cette élogieuse présentation. Lorsqu'on invite, on se demande toujours si les gens vont se pointer. Et j'en suis ravi de voir que vous êtes ici en grand nombre. Ce que je voulais discuter ce soir avec vous, c'est le travail qui se fait actuellement, les recherches, pour évaluer les répercussions du changement climatique sur nos vies en général. Et je vais essayer d'utiliser comme exemple qu'est-ce qui se passe ici, dans les capitales nationales. Et je vais partager avec vous ce que nous avons comme projet particulier ici-là au Canada. Je travaille pour l'organisation ICLEI Canada. On a été fondé comme l'Institut pour les initiatives environnementales. On travaille avec les villes, les municipalités partout au monde. Notre siège social est à Toronto, mais on a aussi des bureaux à Montréal et à Victoria. On essaye d'être rassembleurs pour divers leaders. Le personnel à la ville d'Ottawa peut discuter avec les homologues à Calgary pour discuter de problèmes en commun et ne pas constamment réinventer le fil à couper le beurre. On a deux programmes principaux au Canada, l'un en partenariat avec la Fédération des municipalités canadiennes. Pour réduire les émissions de gaz à effet de serre, on veut faire la transition à une économie faible carbone, créer aussi des plans communautaires et collectifs par lesquels les collectivités peuvent gérer eux-mêmes cette transition. 400 municipalités canadiennes y participent. Et ce soir, ce que je vais concentrer là-dessus, c'est comment bâtir des collectivités souples et résilientes. Nous savons que le changement climatique est un fait, un constat. Si ça représente une certaine part de risque, que peut-on faire pour se préparer à s'y adapter? Non seulement les simples citoyens, les résidents, mais aussi les entreprises, les commerces, etc. On fournit aussi beaucoup d'outils, de documents, d'informations, gratuitement pour la plupart, sur notre site web. Des études de cas, des exemples de projets, etc., qu'on peut partager et peut-être profiter de ce partage. Voici quelques villes avec lesquelles nous travaillons actuellement. Beaucoup, beaucoup de projets au Canada. Je peux vous donner toutes sortes d'exemples, mais c'est pour vous montrer tout simplement qu'il y a énormément de variétés. Depuis 4-5 ans, observer une croissance incroyable. Au tout début, il y a 5-10 ans, il y avait une poignée de municipalités, mais maintenant on a des hameaux de 800 personnes, 1000 personnes, jusqu'au centre métropole, Montréal, Toronto, Ottawa, Vancouver. Voici une photo de groupe de la semaine dernière qu'on a lancé, 25 villes qui sont appuyées par la Commission européenne qui finance cette assemblée des maires. Ça porte un intérêt international, comme vous le voyez bien, et ça commence à bouger un peu partout dans le monde. Pour répéter le point entre l'adaptation et l'atténuation, les deux sont extrêmement importants et ça travaille vraiment main en gant. Si vous voyez la définition qu'on utilise, on est déjà face au changement climatique. Alors l'adaptation, c'est gérer l'inévitable. Ou essayer de réduire les répercussions de l'environnement sur nous. Contrairement, atténuation, réduction des échappements de gaz, etc., c'est d'éviter l'ingérable. Alors, on ne veut pas contribuer à empirer la situation, on ne veut pas augmenter les risques. Alors, il faut les deux volets, adaptation et atténuation. Lorsque je parle de solution, on va dire, mais pourquoi vous ne mentionnez pas tel et tel... Pourquoi pas réduire l'utilisation de voitures individuelles, quoi? Pourquoi pas insister sur le transport en commun? Mais parce qu'il y a deux éléments, il y a l'adaptation et l'atténuation. Maintenant, quelques statistiques. La région d'Ottawa est en position excellente grâce au travail qui se fait par la CCN, la ville d'Ottawa et Gatineau, pour obtenir des projections météorologiques très spécifiques. Qu'est-ce que ça représente pour nous, ici, d'ici 10 ans, 20 ans, 50, 80 ans? Alors, je vous présente quelques exemples pour vous indiquer le genre de changement auquel on peut s'attendre. C'est tout à fait disponible de l'Atlas climatique qui est en ligne. Il y a beaucoup de ressources aussi sur ce site. Mais trois messages principaux. Essentiellement, il y aura des printemps, des hivers plus humides, beaucoup de plus de pluie que de neige d'ailleurs. Les hivers seront beaucoup plus chauds et beaucoup plus de journées chaudes, beaucoup plus. 30 degrés Celsius l'été, bien sûr. Comme vous voyez, la moyenne de 76 à 2005, c'est la moyenne. Alors, c'est à peu près 14 jours au cours d'un été, 21 juin jusqu'à mi-septembre, fin septembre. Et si vous regardiez les projections 2050, 2080, c'est 57 journées très chaudes. On passe de 40 jours à 57 jours où la température va dépasser le 30 degrés Celsius, bien sûr. Ben, ceci a beaucoup de conséquences pour ceux qui n'ont pas de climatisation, pour les itinérants, pour les gens qui travaillent à l'extérieur, pour les très jeunes enfants. Cet excès de chaleur, hein, comment s'adapter, comment traiter de la situation, voilà. Ensuite, le nombre de nuits qui vont au-delà de 20 degrés, on appelle tropical, c'est très bien d'en parler au mois de janvier, mais c'est quand la température de la nuit baisse, bien sûr. Il y a 5 nuits du genre dans la première période, allant à 35 maintenant pour les projections 2050 à 2080. Et quelle est la cause de tout ça? Lorsque la température de la nuit ne veut pas se baisser, les gens sont incapables de dormir comme il faut, convenablement. Ils sont mal reposés et nous savions qu'il y a des conséquences de tout cela, des répercussions le lendemain. On est beaucoup plus de mauvaise humeur, on est plus fragile psychologiquement, etc. Alors la température de la nuit est encore très importante. Alors, bon, généraliser un peu qu'est-ce que c'est, une autre façon de représenter en jaune température, en bleu précipitation et jaune solide la courbe. C'est la projection pour l'avenir, et en pointillé, on voit que c'est... On ne parle pas des vagues de chaleur, on parle d'un réchauffement normalisé, si vous voulez, généralisé. Ça va changer la campagne agricole, la durée des journées ensoleillées, etc. Et précipitation en bleu, alors bleu pâle, je ne sais pas si vous voyez à l'écran, ça représente la période de base, et le bleu foncé, les projections pour l'avenir. Et comme vous voyez, c'est plus sec l'été, alors il va falloir peut-être emprunter des pratiques d'irrigation, il faudrait conserver l'eau, l'utiliser de façon modeste et modique. Alors, réfléchissez un petit peu qu'est-ce que ça représente pour vous, individuellement. Votre résidence, votre lieu de travail, pour vos loisirs, etc. Moi, je demeure à Toronto. Alors, quand je viens à Ottawa, je suis toujours un petit peu jalouse du fait que vous avez accès aux Gatineau et les pentes de ski. Moi, j'aime bien. Vous êtes quoi, à 4 km de distance avant d'aller aux pentes de ski ici, là, dans le parc. Alors, la précipitation, l'hiver, si ça devient de la pluie plutôt que de la neige, ça va beaucoup changer les habitudes des gens, la saison de ski, etc. Il faut réfléchir. Au travail, la voirie, par exemple, est-ce qu'ils seront capable de travailler pendant ces 57 journées par année où ce que c'est la température dépasse le 30 degrés? Ou est-ce qu'il faudrait faire comme on fait dans les pays méditerranéens? On commence plus tôt, on fait un poste ou un quart de travail, on s'arrête quelques heures mi-jour et on reprend vers 16h, 17h, parce qu'il fait trop chaud pour travailler au plein soleil de midi. Alors, voyons comment ça se compare, que ce que nous faisons actuellement, est-ce que nous serons obligés de faire, et quoi faire pour se préparer, pour ne pas se faire prendre par surprise ou à la dernière minute. Préparons-nous pour ces changements. Ensuite, j'ai essayé, dans tous les travaux de recherche que nous avions faits, j'ai essayé de voir qu'est-ce qu'il y avait en façon générale. Ce n'est pas la risque pour Ottawa en particulier, ou les risques, c'est généralisé. Parce qu'il y aura des changements. Alors, il y a de risques accrus d'inondations en raison de précipitations sur les glaces surtout. Parce qu'une fois que le sol est gelé, il n'y a nulle part où on peut vider, si vous voulez. Les égouts l'égout pluvial, par exemple, n'est pas accessible. Alors, il y aura plus de sous-sols inondés, et des impacts sur la santé mentale aussi, je pense. Et ça coûte cher pour 57 000 pour réparer les dégâts lorsqu'une maison est inondée. En tout cas, ce n'est pas une somme qu'on est prêt à payer trop souvent. Hein? Il y a aussi propagation des maladies à transmission vectorielle, la maladie Lyme, le virus du Nil, affectant la santé humaine. Ça commence à être très, très... Les gens qui font la balade, les gens qui ont des chiens, qui se promènent avec leurs chiens, c'est très important. Comment mobiliser pour protéger contre ces risques? Ensuite, bien sûr, il y a l'augmentation des épisodes de santé, de maladies liées à la chaleur, en particulier sur toutes les populations vulnérables. Pour ceux qui ont l'accès financier ou à un réseau social, peuvent éviter les impacts. Il y a plusieurs étés, il y avait des pannes d'électricité à Toronto. On perdait de l'électricité pendant 7-8 jours, pendant toute une été. Les gens ont tout simplement abandonné la ville, ils ont passé à leur chalet. Mais qu'en est-il pour les gens qui n'ont pas de chalet, qui ne peuvent pas quitter, qui sont obligés de rester? Les plus vulnérables, évidemment. Alors la chaleur, estivale surtout, c'est clair que l'impact, bien sûr, ça tombe en majorité sur ceux qui n'ont pas de climatisation, qui peut-être sont mal logés, etc. Nous voyons déjà des stratégies d'adaptation axées sur l'évaluation du niveau de risque, de vulnérabilité. Le projet ici même, à Ottawa, où on a pu identifier qui est vulnérable, quelles sont les vulnérabilités, et on va élaborer les stratégies pour contrer ou protéger contre ces risques, prévoir les risques et les éviter si possible. Ce qui est plus important encore, c'est quelles sont les mesures stratégiques qu'on peut prendre. J'ai quelques exemples ici sur cette photo, peut-être d'autres qui seraient peut-être intéressants aussi. Je vais commencer avec Windsor. Dans la ville de Windsor, on a fait des imageries thermiques sur des terrains de jeux d'enfants avec des ensembles d'appareils, de structures récréatives. Pour des raisons, avec cette imagerie thermique, on voyait que les tapis en caoutchouc atteignaient des températures de 76 degrés Celsius. Écoutez, l'enfant qui est à nu-pied, qui va traverser ce tapis caoutchouté, boum, tout de suite, il va se brûler les pieds de façon assez sévère. Alors, on essaye de mettre des auvents ou des parasols. À long terme, on va changer le matériel. Ce sera plus des structures, mais peut-être des arbres. Mais au moment qu'on avait créé ces parcs pour enfants, on n'avait pas compris l'importance de quels matériaux. Windsor peut surchauffer. Hein? Là, ils vont changer les infrastructures. Ils vont communiquer, sensibiliser le public. Ils ont déjà commencé des campagnes de médias sociaux. Il va faire chaud demain, la semaine prochaine. Soyez prudents dans nos parcs, etc. L'autre exemple, à Vancouver, Vancouver Coastal Health a préparé la cartographie des vulnérabilités sanitaires à la chaleur. Où est-ce qu'il y a beaucoup de béton, c'est très bétonné, la température est toujours plus élevée que dans la ceinture verte. Et qui est là? Qui est prisonnier de leur environnement? Il y a beaucoup d'itinérants. Il y a aussi des populations de résidence pour aînés. Alors, utilisant des données, des statistiques, on va essayer de tailler sur mesure des solutions. Et vous voyez aussi IMAX, les grands écrans cinématographiques. Ils ont installé des rigoles de drainage biologique pour filtrer les eaux de ruissellement des routes et des stationnements. Une façon de faire, c'est remplacer le béton, l'asphalte, avec quelque chose qui peut absorber l'eau un peu. Ils l'ont fait sur leurs aires de stationnement. Ils ont ajouté des tables de pique-nique afin que les employés peuvent aller sortir le midi. Petit avantage. Mais ceci va permettre l'écoulement des eaux de ruissellement. Credit Valley Conservation Authority, l'autorité de conservation de la Valley Credit, ont financé l'étude pour IMAX. Et à l'AMEC aussi, Nouveau-Brunswick, ils ont des tempêtes d'hiver assez importantes, comme on a vu en Terre-Neuve cette semaine, et aussi au Nouveau-Brunswick, bien sûr. On trouvait que les aînés se trouvaient en situation d'isolement. Ils ne pouvaient plus sortir, pas d'accès à aller s'alimenter, des pannes d'électricité. Alors, on a utilisé les églises pour servir d'entrepôt de stockage pour l'aliment, les aliments. Ils ont fait des collectes d'alimentation, etc. Et on s'en servait. Ça ne coûte pas tellement cher. Habituellement, les églises sont d'accord à offrir leur lieu pour entreposer des biens comme ça. Et voilà. Et il y a un dernier programme que j'aimerais mentionner. Le capital social, bien sûr, beaucoup de municipalités ont beaucoup de soucis parce que les gens sont de plus en plus colmatés dans des tours résidentielles. C'est très difficile quand même dans un condominium. Il y a une taille maximale, il y a une taille aussi qui est optimale et pas nécessairement maximale. Il y a du travail qui se fait actuellement à Vancouver dans la... c'est une commune résidentielle, Hayworth. Si on peut peut-être préparer l'environnement et le milieu pour permettre cette société de bons voisins, je vais mentionner d'autres principes directeurs, si vous voulez.
And that impact in one system or one area will have an adverse effect on another system. And the common one that we talk about in my world is between electrical utilities and telecoms, for example, or electrical utilities and water provision, right? If you're on a 7-day power outage, quickly your ability to communicate via all those things that cities are identifying, social media and websites and things, disappears because people can't charge and use their devices. So trying to understand that relationship. Or the other example is, we know with electricity we can pump water up into a 50-80 story building. Without that electricity, we can get that water 6 floors. So is there something we can do on the first 6 floors of a building that people can have access to water if there is no power in that building? So understanding the relationship between those systems is really important. And that most services, assets, or people are going to be or have been affected by a changing climate. So you're hard-pressed to say, well, this is an issue for the building engineers only, and then we healthcare professionals don't have to think about it. Or this is an issue for the parks department. This isn't an issue for the finance department. Each one will be impacted in their own way, and it's important to understand from a systems perspective how that interacts. And then that we need to balance immediate, so those floods that you've seen happen here, the heat waves we've seen happen, along with the long term, that general.
On ne peut pas planifier simplement pour les dangers. On doit songer à changer nos pratiques à long terme. Et je vais me concentrer sur la coproduction également. Mon travail, je le fais avec les municipalités. J'ai commencé en 2001, il y a 19 ans maintenant. Auparavant, les villes consultaient, c'était leur boulot. mais on s'est rendu compte que les consultations doivent se faire avec beaucoup d'acteurs différents. Les villes peuvent les mener, mais il faut tenir compte des gens qui vont créer les solutions également. Ces solutions doivent être sensées, bien sûr, et doivent s'inscrire dans le tissu communautaire auquel elles sont destinées. Il faut que les solutions viennent de la base également, pas seulement du sommet. Et puis, on doit tenir compte de l'interaction. Quand on va chercher à apporter des changements, on a un bel élan d'acquis pour ce genre de travail maintenant. Je vous ai parlé de ces trois projets tantôt avec... vous avez vu l'ensemble des logos que j'avais montré. On a un bel élan acquis au Canada, en Ontario, mais également dans la région ici. Et il est possible de mettre la main à la pâte. Aujourd'hui, par exemple, vous avez l'occasion d'entreprendre plus long et de montrer que vous avez besoin de davantage d'informations. Et je conclue là-dessus.
OK. Pierre.
D'accord. Alors, bonsoir. Je ne sais pas pour vous dans la salle, mais ici, on a une vague de chaleur en avant. Hein? Il fait chaud. Il fait vraiment chaud. Enfin. Alors, bonsoir. Il est important, je pense, quand on parle de changement climatique et d'impact santé, ce qu'on fait dans la vie, nous, en santé publique, c'est souvent de surveiller l'état de santé, de documenter, de compter les blessés, les malades et les morts. On essaie de comprendre aussi les relations, mais je pense qu'il y a... dans la lutte au changement climatique. C'est simple, les changements climatiques, pour ceux qui ne sont pas familiers. C'est de la chaleur et de l'eau. Alors, vous avez tous fait cuire un œuf dans votre vie. Quand on fait chauffer l'eau, au départ, elle est stable. On la fait chauffer, ça bouillonne. Si on oublie le rond allumé, ça déborde. Et puis, c'est un peu ça, les changements climatiques. La variabilité augmente, le mouvement augmente, et puis, à un moment donné, ça devient très chaud. Et ça fait des événements extrêmes de toute nature qui vont influencer notre effet de santé. Ce qui nous intéresse comme extrême, comme aléa, comme danger, C'est tout ça, les vagues de chaleur, mais aussi le froid qui ne disparaîtra pas. Et au fur et à mesure qu'on s'adapte à la chaleur, parce qu'on va le faire physiologiquement, on est moins adapté au froid aussi. On va mettre moins d'argent, on va acheter moins de bottes, moins de manteaux, on va moins renouveler la fournaise et tout, l'isolation de la maison. Et quand il va arriver une vague de froid, parce qu'il va en avoir encore, là, ça va être plus mortel, ça va être plus dangereux pour la santé de la population. Les tempêtes, le vent, les inondations dans les terres intérieures, comme ici à Ottawa, les tornades, les sécheresses, les feux de forêt, les glissements de terrain, ce qui s'ensuit, les avalanches, mais aussi tout ça en cascade, qui arrive un après l'autre. On vient de le voir en Australie, on se dit « ça ne peut pas nous arriver », mais ce n'est pas vrai. Une vague de chaleur, une sécheresse qui amène des feux de forêt, c'est une vague de chaleur en même temps. Tout à coup, il se met à pleuvoir, c'est les inondations, c'est la contamination des eaux. Tout ça peut arriver dans une période de quelques mois. Et ça, quand on subit ça, comme personne, comme village, comme ville, on est extrêmement touché à la fois individuellement, familialement et socialement. Les maladies qui arrivent avec le changement climatique nouvelles, il y en a très peu. Il y a les infections qui nous viennent du sud. La maladie de Lyme est partie à Old Lyme, Connecticut, il y a 40 ans. Et elle a tranquillement remonté. Elle n'existait pas ici. Et maintenant, on a au Canada 2500 cas par année. Et dans 10 ans, on en aura probablement 20 000. C'est devenu aux États-Unis, à partir de zéro, la maladie zoonotique la plus fréquente, l'infection transmise par insectes ou tiques ou animaux la plus fréquente. Donc, des choses comme ça vont arriver. Il y a déjà eu de la malaria à Montréal, à Toronto. Il va en avoir possiblement dans 40-50 ans encore, des cycles locaux. Le reste, c'est une augmentation de maladies qui existent déjà. Donc, plus de maladies respiratoires, cardiaques, cardiovasculaires de toute nature. Des problèmes qui s'ensuivent quand on a des problèmes avec l'agriculture. Donc, les prix des aliments augmentent. On a de l'insécurité alimentaire, une malnutrition. Il peut y avoir aussi des effets sur la plus direct lors de chaleur, des naissances prématurées. On voit des études faites au Québec, là, qui sont à peu près les premières dans le monde là-dessus, qui montrent davantage de prématurité, davantage de problèmes chez les enfants de toute nature et chez les femmes enceintes. Les problèmes de santé mentale aussi, quand tout ça arrive, il reste que si on est déjà fragilisé particulièrement, on va avoir plus de problèmes de dépression qui s'installent, de troubles de stress post-traumatique, particulièrement quand il y a des pertes importantes, pertes matérielles, pertes de son boulot, blessés, décès. Alors, vous voyez, c'est assez simple. Les augmentations, à l'heure actuelle, sont de l'ordre de 15 à 20 la plupart du temps au Canada, dans un pays riche, qui a un bon système de santé et où on peut compenser la plupart du temps. Déjà, on mesure des excès de cet ordre-là lors des vagues de chaleur ou inondations ou autres. C'est pas mineur. Ailleurs dans le monde, c'est pas mal pire. Et ici, ça va rester vivable un grand bout de temps. On va s'adapter à ça. Mais dans certaines zones de la planète, ça va être plus difficile. Il y a déjà, on voit la télé, il semble y avoir beaucoup d'événements extrêmes aux États-Unis et beaucoup en Asie, en Chine. C'est vrai, il y en a plus par là. C'est comme ça. Il y en a moins au Canada un peu. C'est la première partie de la diapositive en haut. La mortalité, elle aussi, varie beaucoup mondialement selon notre état socio-économique, nos mesures d'urgence et notre préparation. Vous voyez qu'au Canada, qui est en blanc dans la deuxième au milieu, il n'y a pas beaucoup de décès parce que les banques de données internationales ne comptent pas moins de 10 décès comme un événement extrême. Il y en a un peu plus aux États-Unis, mais vous voyez, en Russie, particulièrement dans l'est de la Russie, en Chine, en Inde, quand on meurt, quand il arrive un extrême, là-bas, on meurt en masse. Et au niveau des nombres de personnes affectées, ça dépend là, aussi de la densité de la population. C'est la dernière en bas. Et vous voyez que les pays densément peuplés, que ce soit le Brésil, les États-Unis, la Chine ou l'Inde, il y a beaucoup de monde affecté, soit matériellement, soit au niveau de la santé. Les tendances mondiales depuis 35 ans sont claires. Les problèmes liés de toute nature, là, liés aux extrêmes, sont stables au niveau géologique, tremblements de terre, des choses comme ça, mais augmentent au niveau météo et augmentent au niveau hydrologique, multipliés par 3 depuis 35 ans. Pour le Canada et les États-Unis, si on regarde en termes de pertes, il y a un indice qui est fait par les actuaires et compagnies d'assurance qui montre une augmentation marquée où le climat, les changements climatiques ont aussi un rôle à jouer, nous dit-on. C'est pas que ça, là, mais c'est la tendance aussi aux gens à aller s'installer sur le bord de la mer, sur le bord des rivières, à avoir des grosses maisons, ça coûte plus cher, etc. Mais il reste que... Il y a des changements aussi dans les nombres d'événements. La qualité de l'air, habituellement, quand il fait plus chaud, il y a davantage de production de certains polluants. Et on dit qu'en général, ça augmente d'environ 20 % le niveau d'ozone. Et donc, les problèmes asthmatiques reliés, les problèmes cardiovasculaires reliés aussi à l'ozone. On oublie souvent de parler des pollens. La saison de croissance s'allonge. On importe toutes sortes d'espèces exotiques dans nos villes qui toutes produisent beaucoup de pollen. Et le CO2 agit comme un engrais. Et donc, davantage de temps pour croître, davantage de pollen. Et pour certaines mauvaises herbes, comme l'herbe à poux, l'ambroisie aussi, qu'on dit en France, c'est une flambée à travers toute l'Europe à l'heure actuelle. Et c'est une flambée aussi à travers toute l'Amérique du Nord. Alors, partout où on la mesure, on voit que le nombre de personnes allergiques a doublé depuis 25 ans. C'est aussi simple que ça. On est passé de 8 à 17 % à l'heure actuelle dans l'Est du Canada. Si on regarde, il y a des décès avec la chaleur, mais on se dit qu'on va moins mourir l'hiver. D'habitude, on meurt un peu plus l'hiver dans nos pays et un peu moins l'été. Mais si on regarde le futur, ça va être assez différent. Il va y avoir, c'est vrai, un peu moins de décès l'hiver, mais il va en avoir beaucoup plus l'été. Et particulièrement, là, c'est une diapositive un peu compliquée, mais à gauche, vous avez les Amériques du Nord, Amérique centrale, Amérique du Sud. Au centre, vous avez l'Europe du Nord, plus au centre, et puis l'autre bord de la Méditerranée. Et finalement, à droite, vous avez l'Asie, le Nord, donc des parties comme... la Chine, le nord de la Chine, la Russie. Et en bas, vous avez finalement l'Asie, comme l'Asie du Sud-Est et puis l'Australie. Et ce qu'on voit, c'est que certaines régions du monde, c'est déjà très chaud. Les tropiques, là, on ne peut pas aller beaucoup plus chaud sans dépasser les capacités d'adaptation normales du corps humain. On ne peut pas se rendre à une température du corps humain au-delà de 40 sans souffrir beaucoup. Et puis quand il fait 50 plusieurs jours de suite, personne n'est capable de résister à ça. Et c'est ce qu'on voit dans les graphiques sur l'Asie. Au milieu, là, vous voyez le rouge là, qui monte de façon exponentielle. Bien, c'est qu'on est en Inde, là. On est à 50 degrés pendant 30 jours de suite. Il n'y a personne qui résiste à ça. On dépasse les capacités d'adaptation physiologique humaine. Et on voit aussi que le nord, en haut, c'est toujours moins pire que le milieu ou le sud. Ça, c'est une question aussi socio-économique, je dirais. Est-ce qu'on va être capable de payer le chauffage l'hiver puis la climatisation l'été? C'est une présentation du 8 % des Canadiens qui ont à faire des choix difficiles entre bien se nourrir, payer le logement ou payer l'électricité. On voit que c'est variable un peu. Ça ressemble au niveau de l'Union européenne. L'Union européenne est des pays très riches, mais il y a aussi des pays très pauvres. Et si on se compare aux pays comparables, disons la Scandinavie, qui ressemble beaucoup au Canada, bien, on est quand même trois fois plus élevé comme précarité énergétique que la Suède, par exemple. On a encore du chemin à faire de ce côté-là. Et ces mêmes 8 % de personnes qui ne peuvent pas se payer l'électricité ne pourront probablement pas non plus se payer facilement les aliments quand ils coûtent cher. Donc, un problème d'insécurité alimentaire qui est dans la population générale de l'ordre de 7 à 8 % mais qui monte pour certaines sous-populations autochtones, notamment. ces problèmes-là, ça donne une certaine dispersion dans l'espace. Il y a des choses sur lesquelles on peut pas beaucoup, mettons, la géopolitique internationale, le Canada est un petit pays au niveau international, on peut pas agir beaucoup là-dessus, donc ça n'a pas été nécessairement priorisé, même si ça demeure important. Par contre, d'autres secteurs l'ont été, et on en a retenu 6, où est-ce qu'on pense qu'il devrait y avoir une priorisation à court terme. C'est les communautés qui sont plus à risque, d'une part, elles sont plus vulnérables et sont plus exposées. Alors, communauté côtière, communauté nordique, ça réchauffe beaucoup plus dans le nord, et les pêcheries, les gens qui vivent des pêcheries. Et aussi, des choses sur lesquelles on peut agir et qui sont importantes pour les 50, 60 prochaines années, infrastructure physique, la santé et le bien-être humain et les écosystèmes qu'il faut protéger maintenant pour qu'ils puissent... Un écosystème ne peut pas s'acheter la climatisation. Et il ne peut pas déménager. Alors, il faut le protéger. Et c'est important de le faire maintenant pour plus tard. Mais ça varie dans l'espace. Vous voyez que l'Est du Canada, depuis 1950-1948, a beaucoup moins réchauffé que le nord-ouest du pays, par exemple. Québec, la ville d'où je viens, n'a pas beaucoup réchauffé. Plus de variabilité, c'est vrai. Il y a des années où on a 3 mètres de neige, des années où on a 5 mètres de neige. Donc, venez faire du ski à Québec si ça vous tente. C'est encore possible. Et ouais. T'es bienvenu. Mais il reste que la variabilité est là, les extrêmes sont là et les dangers sont là. Et les prochaines années sont, sincèrement, je les trouve un peu dangereuses parce qu'on va pouvoir s'adapter avec le temps. Mais là, ça va très, très vite. C'est une accélération qu'on voit depuis, moi, que je vois depuis 25 ans là, que je suis là-dedans. Ces dernières années, on voit ça arriver là, à une vitesse folle. Et là, j'ai Montréal, par exemple, où il y a, historiquement, Montréal-Laval, à peu près 12 jours à plus de 30 degrés par année. Et c'est déjà changé, là, présentement. L'été passé, il y en a eu 30. Et dans 20 ans seulement, au rythme actuel, on va passer à 50. On multiplie par 4 ou 5, souvent, là, certains de ces risques-là. Et il y a encore 800 000 personnes dans le Grand Montréal qui n'ont pas la climatisation et qui ne pourront peut-être pas se le payer. Et typiquement, ces gens-là qui ne peuvent pas se payer sont aussi, vivent aussi dans des îlots de chaleur. Ici, vous avez, on a fait les îlots de chaleur pour toute la province du Québec. Alors, on connaît en détail tout ça depuis 10 ans. Et puis, 98 % des gens défavorisés, 5e quintile, vivent en îlots de chaleur. Et les premiers quintiles, ben c'est à peu près 0 %. Et ce qu'on a fait dans des études, on a noté une surmortalité lors de vagues de chaleur de 20 à 30 %La moitié des décès dans une vague de chaleur surviennent dans un îlot de chaleur, dans la communauté, chez des gens qui ne devaient pas mourir, qui sont encore jeunes. Et une surmorbidité, donc les gens vont voir leur médecin, sont malades, c'est une augmentation dans ces milieux plus défavorisés-là de 20 % par rapport au reste de la population, qui doivent aller voir leur médecin souvent. Donc, au niveau précipitation, on est gâté, ça ne change pas trop, mais dans une année en moyenne, mais l'été, ça va être plus sec. Alors, on va avoir aussi plus de gastro-entérite parce que c'est plus sec, puis tout à coup, il y a une pluie qui rentre dans le puits de surface. On va pouvoir moins se baigner parce qu'il va y avoir plus de ruissellement, plus de problèmes de ce type-là. En résumé, ces problèmes-là sont importants. Peut-être avoir des problèmes aussi avec le cancer de la peau si on se met tous à trouver qu'il fait beau, puis qu'on va dehors, puis qu'on se fait bronzer, puis qu'on fait des barbecues. Mais c'est mineur relativement dans l'ordre des choses. Ce qui va s'ajouter, qui va être plus socialement, plus difficile socialement, qui va être un vrai défi, c'est toutes les migrations internes. Les gens qui vivent sur les côtes, c'est déjà commencé dans plusieurs sections, Nouveau-Brunswick, Québec. Ils sont obligés de se déplacer. Les gens qui vivent le long des rivières, Le gouvernement du Québec vient de racheter là, une cinquantaine de maisons sur la rivière Chaudière, dans la Beauce. 250 millions, juste pour une rivière, pour une ville, avec toutes les infrastructures à changer. Ça va être des coûts importants. Migration internationale qu'on va voir de plus en plus. Problèmes psychologiques, sociaux, majeurs qui vont s'installer. On veut, nous, agir sur les urgences davantage. C'est un message important. Je pense mieux se préparer, mettre plus d'énergie là-dedans. Et il faut aussi réduire l'exposition, les vulnérabilités. Ça va souvent ensemble. Et des actions pour mieux gérer, mieux organiser tout ça. Je pense qu'une chose importante dans toutes ces discussions-là sur les changements climatiques, c'est de proposer la solution avec le problème. Et donc, de donner de l'espoir qu'on puisse faire quelque chose. C'est ce qu'on essaie de faire le plus possible. Et notre principe de base en santé publique, c'est d'agir pour le plus grand nombre en priorisant les plus vulnérables. Les riches, ils s'organisent eux-mêmes, c'est facile. Comme disait Ewa tout à l'heure, ils s'en vont au cottage, ils prennent un avion, puis ils s'en vont ailleurs. La plupart du monde ne peuvent pas faire ça. On a donc priorisé le verdissement urbain, la lutte aux îlots de chaleur urbains, beaucoup de co-bénéfices pour l'eau. Il y a beaucoup, si tu as des espaces verts, tu fais de l'exercice, ça diminue la pollution de l'air. C'est extrêmement intéressant. On l'a fait en co-design depuis 2009. Et on espère que, là, on a mis à peu près 50 millions là-dedans, et les villes tout autant. Mais là, on espère passer ça à une étape supérieure très bientôt, dans le prochain budget du gouvernement du Québec, qu'on passe à peu près 200 millions par année pour que ça puisse passer à une autre vitesse. Meilleure qualité de vie, d'après nos évaluations, tout le monde est content. Et on inclut là-dedans l'agriculture urbaine aussi. Plus de fraîcheur, on l'a mesuré aussi avec différentes méthodes. Et notre premier ministre nous a annoncé 2 milliards d'arbres à planter. Bien, je lui dis, on va être capable d'en planter quelques centaines de millions chez nous aussi. Ça fait beaucoup de belles choses. On a financé aussi beaucoup d'ONG avec qui on travaille depuis une dizaine d'années. Et notamment les bûcherons de l'asphalte qui s'amusent à enlever, à fermer des rues, à enlever l'asphalte, à y planter des arbres. Et c'est des choses médiatiquement que c'est intéressant, ça attire l'attention. Les gens aiment ce genre de choses-là. On a fait aussi un média, un web média, qui promeut les réalisations positives de tout le monde, individus, municipalités, ONG, en matière de lutte au changement climatique de toute nature, d'adaptation aussi. C'est très populaire. On a mis aussi l'emphase depuis 5 ans sur la formation au grand public, mais aussi des professionnels de la santé, des élus, des directeurs, des professionnels. Et ça marche très bien. On a beaucoup d'inscriptions à nos cours jusqu'ici, à travers le monde. C'est ce qui... Nous motive, c'est ainsi que des solutions sont possibles, particulièrement au Canada, peut-être pas ailleurs. Mais ici, je pense qu'on peut quand même bien s'organiser et réduire sensiblement les impacts sur la santé publique. Il faut commencer à compter aussi les excès de mortalité, les excès de maladies coûtent cher à la société. Si on dit 20 % de plus de problèmes de santé, et comme ça occupe déjà 50 % des budgets de toutes les provinces, si on augmente d'un cinquième, bien, ça va monter à 60 %. Il y a plusieurs secteurs qui vont avoir des problèmes là, à se financer. En tout cas, nous-mêmes, c'est quand même excessif de mettre autant d'argent dans les systèmes de santé. Il faut donc prévenir. Et c'est important. On peut le faire assez facilement avec les vieilles technologies. Moi, je ne suis pas partisan du tout des nouvelles technologies parce que, de mon point de vue, les solutions existent toutes depuis 2 siècles au moins. Vous les connaissez aussi, le train, la bicyclette, le tramway, les impôts et les taxes. Je sais qu'ils n'aiment pas ça dans certaines provinces, mais enfin, la plantation, la foresterie, l'aménagement urbain qui a du bon sens, qui notamment évite les problèmes, qui interdit de s'installer dans les plaines inondables. Les bateaux, le transport par bateau, La marche à pied qui caractérise l'espèce humaine depuis 2 millions d'années, qu'on oublie un petit peu, et le soleil qu'on n'utilise à peu près pas encore au Canada. Alors voilà, il y a de l'espoir, il y a de la vie. Bonne fin de soirée, merci beaucoup.
Okay, thank you very much for coming out, and I personally enjoyed the presentations very much and learned a lot tonight, so it's an honor to be here. I'm going to talk mostly about homes, so maybe you can think about your own house tonight. I'm going to kind of switch between two topics, high wind and extreme rainfall flooding in urban areas, and maybe you can think about what you can do in your own house, I suppose, as I move through my slides. A very quick introduction to our organization. The Institute for Catastrophic Loss Reduction was founded about 20 years ago. We were actually founded by the Canadian insurance industry, the home and auto insurers. We've since become our own organization, and we're an institute of Western University in London, Ontario. So a lot of my background information here comes from the insurance industry in terms of catastrophe losses and that sort of thing. So first, I'm going to give you some numbers. They probably don't mean much because it's insurance. That's what they're there for. They're there to pay losses. So first of all, there's been many billions of losses in the last 10 years or so from natural catastrophes. But we know being the industry that pays for losses, we get a good sort of inside view on what actually causes loss. And when we have these billions of dollars in losses over the decades, we find that most of these losses are coming from extreme rainfall flooding, to a certain extent riverine flooding. The Alberta flood is one example where it was actually a major loss event. Many flood events are not major loss events for the insurance industry because a lot of people are not insured for flooding, if you did not know that. High wind and hail are also major causes of loss for Canadians. And then we've had a number of very big wildland fire events, including the fire event that affected Fort McMurray a few years ago, which was one of the biggest loss events in the history of the world insurance industry, which is surprising given that it was a relatively small community in northern Alberta. And it signifies, I think, the exposure in Canada that we have to these types of losses. If you think about the thousands of small communities in northern Canada that are exposed to wildland fire, that one event, as big as it was, is an indicator of what could happen. One thing I want, I guess, people here to take away from my presentation is when we get these catastrophe events, most of the losses are caused to homes. Homes, buildings, contents, what's inside the house, and then the amount of money or time it takes for people to live outside of the home while it's being rebuilt. So two examples there. On the left is basement flooding, which I'll talk about in a minute. Roughly 80% of the losses from these big flood events are to houses, not, you know, cars and commercial businesses, that sort of thing. It's caused to houses. The one in the middle, my label has gone there, but that's high wind events. Again, roughly 80% of losses during these high wind events are caused to houses. And then when we look across all types of disasters, it's roughly 60%. And I'll get into some detail about why. So first, I want to talk about high wind. So we've been working with the wind engineering group at Western University for about 20 years with the facilities they have there, looking at vulnerabilities of typical wood frame home construction, the types of homes that many of us live in, semi-detached, detached homes, that sort of thing, where you have studs that are made out of wood and that sort of thing. Most of us live in houses like this. So there is a boundary layer wind tunnel there, which is a special kind of wind tunnel that's specifically designed for looking at wind impacts on buildings. There's also a full-scale testing facility that's affectionately referred to as a Three Little Pigs lab, where a full-scale home was constructed and a high wind event is mimicked on the home, and then the home is investigated and we look for failures in the structure afterwards. And there's an example on the right of a toenail failure, and I'll explain that in a minute. And then another big part of the program is field inspection. So anytime there is a high wind event, a tornado event, within, you know, a day's travel of London, Ontario, an engineering team is on site and they look at the debris and they identify how the buildings failed, and then that's all reported and published later on. So I think one of the less intuitive aspects of high wind is how buildings are actually affected. So I think if you're lying in bed at night and you feel a strong wind event move through, you can kind of feel your building shaking a bit. And I think if you think about a wind field moving through your house or past your house, you'll think of it as kind of pushing on the side of the building. That certainly is one force, but one other force that we really seem to have a lot of damage from in Canada from the type of wind events that we get here is uplift forces. So as that wind moves past the building, it's creating negative pressure on the roof. That pulls on the roof and the different components of the roof, and that's what actually causes a lot of damage in Canada. So we wrote a report, a public report, if anybody's interested in mitigating wind loss in their building, or if you're building a new house or buying a new house and you want to ask your builder about it, there is a report available. It's going to be turned into a national standard in the coming 2 years or so. But basically, the way to mitigate wind damage in a building and in a home associated with these uplift forces is you tie everything together. You put on good wind-rated shingles. You make sure that the roof sheathing, so your shingles rest on sheathing. Make sure that sheathing is well connected to the roof structure, that the roof structure is well connected to the building where it sits on the wall. And then that uplift pulling load is passed all the way down to the foundation, and that keeps the building together during these high wind events. It's not terribly complicated. Of course, the details are, but that's basically the concept. So both the lab testing and the field investigations have found one common vulnerability in home construction, and that is where the roof structure rests on top of the load supporting walls. And so these are pictures of that. It's a little bit hard to see, but think about if you've ever stuck your head up in your attic, you see trusses. Those trusses sit on top of the wall. That's what we're looking at right here on the bottom, on the left of the screen. That's from that lab I mentioned before. In a typical home in Canada, we have what we call toenail connections. Basically, three nails that are nailed diagonally in through that roof member into the load supporting wall. And that is meant to keep the roof on the house so it doesn't slide around in say an earthquake, something like that, and also resist a bit of uplift force. What's been consistently found in these post-damage inspections is that some of those nails are missing. It's very hard to inspect. Building inspectors often are not allowed to climb up and look at it for health and safety reasons, and sometimes they're missed. And when they're missed, the uplift resistance of that connection is greatly reduced. And there's some examples on the right. The top picture is a toenail connection in Vaughan, Ontario, after the tornado there in 2009, where there's only one nail, there should be three. And then we have the three bottom pictures there. These are all from Gatineau following the September 2018 tornadoes, where there was missing toenail connections. We know that this is a common theme in wind damage. Another common theme that we see is it's all related to the roof in Canada mostly, or largely related to the roof. So this is an example of roof sheathing and roof cover, so shingle loss, which in and of itself is not a major type of damage to a building. It's not a major structural concern. But the concern is when you have these storms with tornadoes and that sort of thing, you also get rain. And when you lose your shingles, when you lose roof sheathing, rain gets into the building and really intensifies the damage. And so the argument is, if you can keep the roof together, you keep the components of the roof together, you keep the roof on the wall, you can greatly mitigate damage. And I'm going to show a video now, if we can. We're working with a very progressive builder in Southern Ontario municipality who has been working on implementing some of these measures in their homes. And the video doesn't really tell you what he's doing, and I'll explain that afterwards, but it tells you why he's doing it. He's a very progressive builder, and so when we can get that up there, it would be good.
Climate resiliency pilot project with Institute for Catastrophic Loss Reduction in Doug Terry Homes. And the purpose of the project is to be able to take what's learned in the lab at Western University and make it scalable so that all builders are able to do it cost effectively.
Across Canada, one of the most common forms of losses for homeowners comes from severe wind. Frequently all across the country. It's our view from our research that much of that it can be prevented, and the best time to prevent it is in initial construction.
So we're literally trying to make it not only doable and scalable, but fast and affordable. That's the entire point, is making it so that all builders have the ability, the technology, and the affordability to do this. So we can do these beautiful net zero homes, and that's wonderful, but we also have to make them more resilient, because if we don't and they end up in a landfill because it got blown up by an EF2 tornado, we didn't do our job.
It's our belief that future generations of homeowners can live in much safer homes, homes that are resistant to further damage, homes that will be safe.
Making the homes become more resilient so they're more able to withstand high wind events, I think, is critically important. And the knowledge we're gaining here is going to be open book, so that any builder is going to be able to come and see this research and understand how to do it.
For us, it's incredibly exciting and very rewarding to be able to take ideas and concepts, see them done in practice, and hope that the next generation of Canadians will be better protected from things like severe wind and tornadoes. For us, this is what the work is all about, to try to bring new ideas and improve the safety for Canadians.
All right, you might have caught a glimpse of me in there somewhere. Anyway, so we're working with this builder, Doug Terry, in St. Thomas, Ontario. So we do a lot of this work in the lab, and we make our recommendations, but the recommendations are coming from academics. So this was a builder who was interested in the topic, but he wanted to make it actually doable at sort of a mass scale for home builders. And so what we did with Doug Terry in St. Thomas was we really boiled down the mitigation measures to the absolute minimum measures that can be done to address these key vulnerabilities of that roof-to-wall connection and the sheathing connection to roofs. And it's very hard to see, and if you were living in one of these houses, you would never know that this was done. But there's two things that were done here. There's a screw like this, a 6-inch truss screw that is driven in through the top of the wall into the roof structure. Rather than just having those toenails, we also have a screw in there. And there's about 50 connections typically on a home like that. And the other thing we're doing is moving from just a 2-inch nail to fasten your roof sheathing onto the supporting members to a 2.5-inch nail. And that works out to, for a framing crew, maybe 1 or 2 extra hours of work and maybe $150, $200 that's charged to the builder. And that will address those key vulnerabilities for up to EF2 tornadoes, as was described in the video. And so EF2 is an important sort of cutoff for high wind. It's considered sort of the maximum wind event that a typical wood frame structure can resist, with a few additional changes in its connections. And so I've got some pictures there. The top left is a sort of a typical EF1 type damage, where you've lost some roof cover and sheathing. The one in the middle is EF2. That's sort of the worst type of damage you get in EF2. The whole roof is missing. And then on the far right is EF3, and that's actually a picture from Dunrobin, Ontario. Another reason why EF2 is a good target is because we're going to cover most of the tornado events that we get in Canada, and indeed most of the high wind events. So this map on the bottom is showing you the damage track for the Dunrobin tornado, and you probably know that the Dunrobin tornado is considered an EF3. And EF3, it was classified as EF3 based on the worst observed damage in that tornado, like that image on the right where all the walls were removed from a building. But you'll notice that there are only very small parts of that tornado track that were actually EF3 level damage, and the remainder of the track is EF2, EF1, EF0. So even with measures that target EF2 level damage, we can mitigate most of the damages from EF3, EF4, EF5 tornadoes. And as I said, it can be done very inexpensively. I'm going to turn very briefly to extreme rainfall flooding. So this is a very specific kind of flooding that we deal with a lot, I think, across Canada, that's sometimes overlooked. So this is the July 2013 storm in Toronto. It was the most expensive urban flood event that we've had so far in Canada was about $1 billion dollars in losses. One of the characteristics of urban flooding that's a little bit different than coastal and river flooding is that it can occur almost anywhere. So this is a picture of locations where homeowners made an insurance claim for flooding in the Greater Toronto Area after that storm. The shaded areas are the river floodplains. And you'll see, if you look closely, you'll notice that most of the locations where the flooding actually occurred are not in those river floodplain areas. They're spread out through throughout the urban area. And the reason why this happens is because we're talking about rainfall that is incredibly intense, way beyond the design standards for typical stormwater infrastructure. And there's a number of examples on the right there of recent storms in Ontario. One very notable example is the North York storm from 2005, where there's 132 millimeters accumulated over 2 hours. So just imagine 130 millimeters of rain in 2 hours. That storm back in 2013 in Toronto was about 126 millimeters in 6 hours. So when you get storms like this, you know, almost anybody can be vulnerable to flooding. When homes do flood during these events, there's typically three major causes of flooding. So three ways that the water actually gets into the house. The first top left is stormwater flooding. And I think this is the kind of flooding we think of when we think of flooding in urban areas. Water flowing over the ground, it goes in through doors and windows into houses. But a bigger, more important cause of flooding is sewer backup. So the image on the right is an example of both a storm and wastewater system, a sanitary sewer system under the ground that have become overwhelmed with water and are now backing up into homes. We know this is a major cause of flooding because it's typically, or it has been until about 2015, the only type of flooding that's been insured for homeowners. And so it's driven most of the loss. And of course, when you're talking about sewer backup, you're talking about raw sewage being reversing into your home. So it's concerning for a lot of reasons. And then a final sort of major type of flooding is infiltration flooding. So this is related to groundwater. So if you think about the groundwater table rising above your basement floor, water leaking in through cracks and loose joints and that sort of thing is also a major cause of flooding and very, very difficult to mitigate. So that's something that we need to pay a bit more attention to when we're planning our cities. In terms of mitigating the impacts, there's a number of different things that a typical homeowner can do if you have a home with basement. But there are two main categories, and I think it's kind of important to remember. One thing you can do is protect your own house. The other thing you can do is reduce the amount of water that your home contributes to the municipal system, to the municipal sanitary sewer system or possibly storm sewer system. And when you reduce the amount of water you contribute to the sewer system, you reduce risk for yourself, but also your neighbors and other people in the neighborhood because you're not contributing to flooding. And a major way you would do that is disconnecting downspouts from sanitary sewers and also foundation drains from these systems. So if you're not familiar with foundation drain, it's a perforated pipe. It goes around underneath the ground, around your footing. It was common in many neighborhoods to connect that to the sanitary sewer. And so when you get a big storm, the water goes directly into the sanitary sewer. They're not designed to handle huge amounts of water, and then you get sewer backup. So the good news about this type of hazard is that there are retrofit programs. There are many programs across Canada where a local jurisdiction typically will give you money to mitigate this type of hazard. One of the things that we found looking into these programs is that uptake is very low. There's a number of reasons for that. One is because people get flooded, they hear it was a 100-year return period event, and they say, well, I'm good for another 99 years, which is not how it works. But there's other reasons as well. There's a lot of disruption, that sort of thing. A few cities have been able to get uptake up pretty high using pretty aggressive means. But I wanted to point out that Ottawa, the City of Ottawa, has an excellent subsidy program. And if you're a homeowner in Ottawa, you should absolutely look into it. There are thousands of dollars on the table to mitigate risk in your own home, to disconnect your foundation drains and install backwater valves and that sort of thing. It's one of the best programs in the country with very good inspections and all that sort of thing to make sure that things are installed properly. So if you haven't looked into it, you can just Google Ottawa Basement Flood Program and it'll come right up. And I think a good part of the city is eligible if you're in a home with a basement. One of the things that we're working on at ICLR is understanding how these systems work over time. So one example is a backwater valve. This is a system that's or a tool that you can install in your sewer connection to reduce the risk of water from the sewer backup backing up into your home. One of the things that you got to think about is maintaining that. Debris builds up over time. And again, there's good guidance on the Ottawa website on maintenance of those systems. I'm just going to end my presentation with turning back to wind. So this is obviously Dunrobin. I should ask, was anybody here affected by those tornado events? Okay. All right, at least one person. So one of the things we're doing, again, with the researchers at Western is trying to get a better understanding. So we spent a lot of time looking at structures, which I described before, and we kind of boiled down the mitigation aspects to those two key components. We also want to understand how wind affects neighborhoods at the neighborhood scale. And we're starting with a case study from Dunrobin. So at Western, there's a pretty advanced wind lab. The Windy Dome, it's one of the few wind labs in the world where you can simulate a tornado indoors. A scale model of Dunrobin is being developed, and then very quickly I'll show you the video and kind of explain what's happening if possible. But basically what we'll be doing, the researchers at Western led by Horia Hangan there, we'll be running the tornado through the model of the community and investigating the different wind pressures that are experienced throughout the community. And that should help us develop a method to understand how different communities are vulnerable to wind impacts. So this is inside the lab. This is the simulated tornado on Dunrobin. I can't quite see how that tornado is moving through the community. That's one of the features of this lab, that you can actually translate the tornado through infrastructure and communities and that sort of thing. It's very preliminary still, and if of interest, you can contact me and we'll keep you up to date. But as a homeowner, I think the structural aspect that I mentioned before is probably more of interest. And with that, I'll say thanks very much for listening and look forward to questions.
Okay, thank you very much to all of our speakers. So we're going to move into the question period. So we've got two microphones set up in the room. So those of you who are interested in asking questions, I invite you to come. Donc, si vous avez des questions, on a deux microphones. Mais avant de commencer, je vais lancer une question pour le panel. So before we get to the audience questions, we're just going to ask one question to the overall question to the panel. And I'm building this on off of something that Eva gave some examples. So I'm going to ask each of you regarding what examples or programs are you aware of across the country that you would consider good examples for climate change adaptation, human health, and other things related to climate change. So Eva, you can start. You gave some examples, but if there was one that you think is particularly of interest.
I think the most interesting examples are coming where jurisdictions are doing things at different scales. So they're working on their own assets and things they own or operate, so as a municipality, whether that's roads or buildings. But they're also partnering up to do work with different types of services. So in the area around Burlington and Hamilton, for example, there's a lot of work being done to put green infrastructure. So those bioswales I showed are an example of rain gardens. So natural features that can absorb water. So they're Burlington did some work to put them on school grounds. So you can see they're partnering with the school board. They're getting children involved in planting them. So there's an educational component. And not only are they doing that to they're putting it in the right of ways in their own infrastructure that they operate, but are reaching out to extend that. They're also doing some interesting work to partner with a group called Faith in the Common Good, realizing that the area around Greater Toronto, very similarly to Ottawa, I would imagine there's a lot of newcomers and new Canadians who come from parts of the world where there's maybe mistrust of local governments and governments in general. And so municipalities, and there's an interesting example in Brampton, they're partnering with faith leaders, whether those are imams or rabbis, pastors, priests, to act as hubs. So the project's called the Lighthouse Project, and they're training faith leaders to act as resilience hubs in communities. So they receive some training and some physical upgrades to their buildings. So again, whether that's a synagogue or a mosque or a church, whatever it is, they get training around emergency preparedness. But the kind of only catch, as it were, is that faith hub has to act interdenominationally. It's a community neighborhood hub and not a hub for people of only that faith. So it's a really interesting way to harness some new messengers and trusted voices to communities, and not say that the emergency services department or the fire services has to be the only place to go out. So there's some really good examples of creative partnerships and acting at different scales that I think could be replicated.
That's really interesting. Pierre?
Oui. Écoutez, au niveau santé au Canada, Santé Canada dit depuis 10 ans, et puis des études externes aussi faites par McGill ont dit que le programme de santé que nous avons développé au Québec depuis 15 ans est le meilleur au Canada. Alors, je me fie à eux, même si j'ai été un peu impliqué là-dedans, personnellement.
Merci. Dan.
Okay. One of the big programs that I like quite a bit, and I think will have a big impact over time, is the National Research Council's Climate Resilient Buildings and Core Public Infrastructure project, which involves looking at all of the codes and standards that are under their sort of responsibility in incorporating climate change resilience aspects into them. So, for example, the National Building Code, National Plumbing Code, et cetera. They're developing new climate data to incorporate into the codes, and this could have very significant impacts on building design in the future. They're also looking at many projects concerning wildland-urban interface fire, extreme heat, heat health, flooding, different aspects of flooding, all related to buildings to mitigate the impacts. I think in the long run, this is going to have a very major impact on Canada.
Great, thank you. So we're going to go questions with the audience, and we'll go back and forth to the mics. We'll start over there.
Hi, my name's Adam. I work for the city of Ottawa. And first, I wanted to thank you. This is great, and it's really heartening to hear that people are, you know, smart people are giving this a lot of thought. So one thing that got mentioned only a little bit was migration. And I saw a talk by Diane Sachs. She talked to the Kingston City Council. And she sort of, if I can characterize it, said, you know, we're going to be pretty well off relative to the rest of the world, right? So if you combine that with sort of UN projections of migration, which are saying we're going to go from a few million a year to maybe 100 million a year, to me, that seems like a far larger impact on our society, on our lives, on our livelihoods. And I'm curious to hear sort of comments on that aspect of adaptation generally. Yeah.
Thank you. Who wants to start?
I can't see you all there. I can start. So Councillor Gord Perks is a councillor at the City of Toronto. He said at council that it is the biggest climate impact that the City of Toronto should be thinking about is environmental refugees and sort of climate-related migration. And so it's one of those things that is still this emerging issue that nobody quite knows how to understand or plan for, but it's certainly coming up more and more frequently. And I think in some cases, the inclusion of, like in Toronto's 100 Resilient Cities strategy that they released as one of the four Canadian cities through that program, they really worked with newcomer agencies to understand what services are most used by newcomers when they come to Toronto. Is it about finding housing? Is it about accessing their own, you know, community and services in their language or whatnot? So they're trying to understand what could build the adaptive capacity or the ability of people to prepare among new Canadians. But in terms of, you know, understanding how do we rebuild our cities and what are the numbers that we're planning for, I think it's still pretty early days in being able to put concrete numbers to that.
And you can see what's happening to Europe in the recent years. We're seeing climate migration about a million a year, and it's creating a big problems everywhere. So you cannot build a city of 1 million new people every year in any parts of the world. There needs to be some other preventive work done elsewhere out of Canada in this case, because of course we will get more. We remain attractive, and but you cannot manage those numbers in any case, I believe.
Okay. Question over here.
Yes, please. A question to the first speaker. In one of your earliest slides, you showed the towns that you're working together with, cooperating with, or whatever. And I couldn't help but notice that most of those were on Vancouver Island. So I'm curious about whether that's a fluke or why that is. And secondly, of course, the general question of how do you decide who to join up with, and what are the criteria primarily?
That one wasn't a fluke. It was the Real Estate Foundation of BC. Which is a really, they take a portion of all the real estate transactions in the province, they put it into this foundation, which funds work around sustainability and climate and livability. And so when we opened up an office on Vancouver Island, it seemed a logical fit to build a project to submit to the Real Estate Foundation. So that one, as a nonprofit, you know, to some degree, we're responded to what our funding parents want us to do. So that's the reason we're working on the island. But it was quite strategic to work regionally. So if you know Vancouver Island, the communities that are listed off there are sort of center island, like Nanaimo, Port Alberni, and south. Because we thought these are all relatively small communities outside of Victoria and Saanich, the two bigger ones. We thought they don't all need to be doing this independently. Their impacts are going to be fairly similar. Some differences if they're right on the coast, like Euclid, Tofino, for example, or if they're a bit more inland. But in terms of projections, it's not going to be too different. So we wanted them to be able to create a network together. Once our project wraps up, we can't continue to be as actively involved in all these communities without some funding. They now have their own little group. So by grouping these municipalities together, as opposed to trying to do hodgepodge, you know, one on the island, one in the interior, one in Alberta, you know, we're kind of creating little communities of practice that can live on and continue this work. In terms of how we select, again, my first answer sort of applies. Ideally, in our work, we can access a little bit of resourcing to put an open call from communities that want to do this work. Because that first program I mentioned, the Partners for Climate Protection, it's voluntary. Anybody can join, and we have some resources to support them. Ours, we say that the work needs to be done within 2 years. And so we really need a coalition of the willing that want to act, and not ones that, oh, we'll sign on to get a nice PR release, and we're not really going to do anything. We want communities that are prepared to put in some elbow grease to keep this moving, because we don't, you know, the IPCC report a couple of years ago said it was 11 and a half years, 12 years, and it's a ticking clock. So we need municipalities that are ready to start taking action now. So we kind of hope they'll choose us because they're looking for something to work through.
Thank you. Next question, prochaine question.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm delighted to be here. My name is Sharon Chisholm, and I really enjoyed the presentations that we had tonight. It's hard for me, and I know the middle gentleman spoke to us about hope and I think hope's an important characteristic, but it's very hard for me to feel hopeful knowing that we've been looking at this problem now for over 50 years. And we've known global warming is coming, now it's a global emergency that we face. So my interest is in talking about big shifts that we have to make as human populations around how we live, how we move, and how we accept others, because I think that's been already dealt with tonight in the questions. A huge amount of people moving in the country, within the country, and coming into the country. When you look at Canada as a big white spot on the map, you know, it's almost like a beckoning sign. So how do we prepare to take care of our current population and a growing population that will certainly have to face? And I think in terms of the people that came here tonight and the NCC sponsoring it, we're talking about cities and the things that cities can do and where they need to have other partners involved. But certainly we've done very little to talk about sprawl in Canada. We love sprawl, you know. How are we going to get around that? How, when people can't afford the gas for their cars, how are they going to shop and get food into their homes? So all this is a major change, and you already see people moving to working at home, which I think keeps them off the road a lot of the time, but we're still building major highways and we're not building any kind of public transit in many areas. Certainly in Nova Scotia, where I'm from, you don't see too much of it. We are supposed to celebrate rails to trails, but we have nowhere to go back to when people aren't able to get into cars. So we need a rail system. We need some kind of system to get people around. And we need to imagine small villages of people living within cities that can talk to each other, that can get their food within a short distance, that can walk rather than drive, that sort of thing. So I'm really excited about what we can do there. And I just want to give you an example of what can be done. About 15 years ago, Scotland decided that they were going to become self-sufficient and not use fossil fuels anymore within the country. And over the last 15 years, they're producing enough power with wind generation that almost covers everything that they use as a small country. They can do it. Certainly Canada can do it. But we haven't even started to talk about those kind of goals yet. So I think they're hugely important, and I just want to ask someone to answer the question, what are the big issues for you? What are the big system changes that we can and must consider now?
Okay, so that's the question we'll throw out, and then we'll...
I just had one comment. One leading light, I think, in when it comes to disaster management in Canada and globally, is the success that we've had in Ontario with the Conservation Authority system in controlling development in floodplains over the past, 50 plus years, amongst, great opposition and grumbling, and keeping it together all this time. And when we've had these floods, Ottawa, Gatineau, we've seen less damage, considerably less in Ontario. And the studies are over and over again. It's common sense. You keep people out of the floodplain. Actually practicing it is difficult because there's lots of pressure to develop these areas, but we've done it with conservation authorities. It's probably one of the best systems in the world. They can't do it in the U.S. Many European countries struggle with it. We've done it in Ontario, and we should recreate it.
Okay.
Just super quickly, one of the things I think we need to get back to, and this is something that I quickly mentioned in that Hey Neighbor collective, which is just a sense of neighborliness. If you're more likely to borrow a cup of sugar, a lawnmower, a book from your neighbor, you've built social capital, you've built a neighborhood that is more prepared for climate, irrespective of whether you nail your toenails or whatever you do. Like, the impact will still happen, but you'll be better prepared to deal with it if you have that social network. So building our communities in a way that allows for that human connection and trying to enable that as city planners and service delivery organizations, because I think people don't join clubs anymore. People aren't doing the things that connect them. So kind of creating those systems. I think people don't think about that as a systems change because, to Pierre's slide, walking's been around for 2 million years and the sun before that. It's kind of a simple thing, but if you just talk to people, you are creating a systems change of and creating an area that's more resilient. So I think we shouldn't forget about that. And you're just creating a better place to live, right? And you can enjoy that.
I think that we're lucky in Canada that we've had examples. If I've been listening to the news about the blizzard in St. John's, and there's a lot of that. I lived through the ice storm in Montreal, and there was a lot of that. It was hard. I had 14 days without electricity and whatever, but the camaraderie and the neighborliness showed, and it came out. And I think that, I don't know whether that's a, you know, I don't think that's solely a Canadian thing, but we do have something to work on with that. We have a base.
So in short, we need more catastrophes to get a real change.
That's when you know.
Don't worry, they're coming.
Do you have a question? We have a lot of people waiting, so I want to keep the question short and the answers short. So,
in order to avoid the heat, for example, like India, have they thought about building a forest over their city?
A what? Forest.
Over. Another word, green roof, but I'm talking about major, like a forest.
Well, there. I'm sure that, I don't know whether that's this specialization of anybody on the panel, but there's green infrastructure that people are trying to do around the world, but then it also depends on the climate. In certain climates, it's much more difficult to grow leafy trees, etc., and that provide shade. So I don't think anybody here is able to answer that specific question. So we're going to move on.
Hi, my name is Peter. I'm a tenant, and I wanted to mention something about Dan's presentation that struck me. By and large, almost entirely, actually, we're talking about homeowners. And that leaves out a very large group of people, especially, say, Centretown, Ottawa, who don't own, who rent, and who are affected by climate change catastrophes and disasters. So, I mean, one of the things that I'm kind of curious about is whether or not the liaisons that you're making with the builders are also mirrored with liaisons with, like, major landlords. Also, I'd like to know what your take is on the provincial government's recent move towards allowing builders and architects to train their own building inspectors and have the those building inspectors do the inspections rather than municipal ones.
I think that's still in a suggestion phase, but
yeah. Well, so on the high rise issue generally,
not high rise. We're just talking.
Oh, not okay. Renters, low rise renters. So, well, one issue that is certainly a concern for flooding is basement apartments. And okay, so there you go. And so if a homeowner with a basement gets the basement flooded, it's inconvenient. It's not necessarily a big deal. It's a big cost. But when you're a basement apartment dweller, your whole life is wiped out. And I think we have not effectively mobilize that part of the population yet. When the cities focus on their basement flood mitigation programs, they tend to go to the neighborhoods where most people complain. Those tend to be the people with social capital, with the resources and the knowledge to know how to complain, know how to make things happen. I'm on a working group at the City of Toronto on flooding, and this is a topic that comes up all the time. How do we prioritize neighborhoods based on not just who's complaining, but who's most vulnerable? And not only the legal apartments, but the many, many illegal apartments that the city does not know about. So I think we're trying to work toward that topic. It's the squeaky wheel gets the grease sort of thing, but we totally understand. I think Toronto is going to start leading some work on that. On your other topic, I said in the email when I responded to that to my colleague, yikes.
But there are, I mean, Dan's presentation highlighted, so it's the damage to the dwelling, but the damage to the items within the dwelling. So we put out a series with some work we did with the cooperators, just some really simple things of what people get most upset about that they lost are irreplaceable things. So putting them on high shelves as opposed to boxes on the floor, you know, making sure that your possessions are elevated. They're not going to stop the flood from happening. Obviously, there's work that needs to be done with landlords and, you know, the landlord-tenant board and everything. But in terms of trying to protect oneself and one's possessions, there's some simple things that if we communicate out, you know, are about an afternoon of work as opposed to thousands of dollars of changes. So it's not a perfect solution, but at least a Band-Aid.
Thank you. Prochaine question, next question.
My name is Bria. I'm a land use planner, and I work primarily in the land development industry. And so in certain sectors, obviously, there's a lot of comfort in talking about these issues and comfort talking about risk and adaptation. And I'm wondering if you have advice for how to talk to developers, builders, who may not be as familiar sort of with the background about adaptation and its benefits.
So, I mean, we've been working with the building industry for a number of years. We had to find a way to talk to them about it. And I think they're concerned about introducing new risks with new ideas into their business. If we ask for too many things, is it going to create a problem with callbacks? Are they going to have problems with building inspections, that sort of thing? This example with Doug Terry was a breakthrough for us. I think we started engaging directly, say, with the Canadian Home Builders Association research committees and that sort of thing, started presenting the work. They understand. They understand, like anybody else does, that that disasters have serious impacts. And if you can present to them meaningful solutions that are not difficult to implement, that are not a major business change, our experience is that they've been receptive.
Thank you. We'll take one question on this side.
Yeah. Just how do we get our municipalities and MNRF to get across to people that you can't just plant grass? It's not the same thing as putting in a willow tree or something to soak up the water. We're allowing a lot of developments to have extremely hard surfaces, and nobody goes in and says, look, that's probably not a good idea in this particular area. MNRF says, yes, you have to restore on the shoreline your natural plants. Well, palm trees are natural. They don't say native. They don't seem to know the word. Those native trees are quite a bit different from some of the others that I've seen planted in many areas because they don't soak up the water. I remember one person from the Rideau Valley Conservation Authority in his newsletter years ago said, stop mowing grass. Just lie down in your hammock and enjoy the scene. Because all you're doing is creating a rug for the water to run off and rise up and put in some red osier dogwood and some of these other things. But they don't seem to really educate people on how to mitigate some of the floodwaters that are around them. And those are the responsibility of some of the things that I've mentioned, and they have to be educated. They know how to do it, but they just don't educate us, I guess.
You'll be really happy to know that there is a massive amount of work in exactly this space on advancing nature-based solution and bringing back nature into cities and into urban environments to serve that function. So there's work that I'm sure people in this room are well-versed on, the Municipal Natural Assets Initiative. It's headed out of work in BC, but it's done across the country to value the services that those natural assets provide. And well, and so the assessments are being done on, because what may be a native plant now will not be a native plant for the future.
With climate change and with different things, unfortunately, some of those things are going to change, and you may need to use plants that can adapt to environmental situations that exist today. And we find that a lot with salt. So the issue of salt being used on roads and everything, certain native plants don't respond to salt, but there are other plants that can survive in salty environments. And so then there's, you sometimes want to, if it's appropriate, introduce a non-native plant if it's appropriate. J'avais une question pour Pierre. You showed some pictures. T'avais montré dans un des diapos des images de quartiers où on avait verdissé, où on avait mis. Sais-tu, est-ce que il y avait, est-ce que ça faisait partie d'un programme? Est-ce qu'ils ont choisi les espèces? Comment ça fonctionnait? Est-ce que tu savais ça?
It has become important to choose species that will resist to future droughts and heavy rain and everything. So we're choosing, if possible, native plants that will resist in the future. But if it's not possible, then you may choose something that is already adapted not so far, a few hundred kilometers to the south, and that's the normal way things will go anyway. The climate we'll get here is the one that already exists in Tennessee at the present time. We'll get that in 30 years from now. So we may play with analog situations to choose the right plants. And you're right that not mowing your lawn adds 2 or 3 degrees of decreases heat by 2 to 3 degrees compared to a completely mowed lawn. So that's interesting. We're proposing that in most parks of Montreal for next year, I believe. They'll start not mowing most of the parks.
As an interesting point, the NCC has a program where we do not completely mow our lawns along many of the parkways. There's a misnomer that some people think is just because the NCC is cheap and we don't want to do it. There are actually, aside from the environmental temperature-wise, there are also other species at risk that live in that larger, longer grass and everything. So, longer grass is also used as a decoy to prevent Canada geese because they don't like the longer grass also. So there are a lot of reasons. So just point out there anyone who's out there listening or watching.
But next question.
Ticks love them.
Yes. Well, you've got one on one side and one on the other. Then you've got the problem with the ticks.
Yeah. Thank you for very hope-giving presentations. There seems to be natural evolution of the questions. My question is actually about natural asset management, in particular whether you have examples of communities where they go around strategically identifying, you know, what the natural assets might be, for example, in relation to storm flood management, and how do you manage that when they are on private land? What kind of arrangements are made, you know, to, short of complete expropriation, but what kind of compromises are struck if particular areas that are in private land are identified as strategic importance for natural asset management?
There's a couple of examples. So the city of Courtney on Vancouver Island is doing that. They're going around looking and trying to, from a managing stormwater and floodwaters perspective, understanding what parts of the community are where it would be more beneficial to kind of renaturalize and bring back wetlands. But to your kind of second question around kind of working with private landowners, I think some of the most interesting work is actually being funded by Natural Resources Canada out in the Bay of Fundy. And it's called Making Room for Wetlands, I think. And they're working along the edge of agricultural communities and traditional dikes. And they're realizing that the dikes, in order to protect the agriculture, would have to be so high that it's just not possible. So they're trying to, through partnerships and a lot of engagement and awareness raising, talk about, well, actually, if we naturalize this area, it'll serve a better function for keeping kind of inundation waters out. And it's really slow. And they've had to bring in a lot of people with specialties and expertise in communications. And they've done a lot more listening than talking, sort of, you know, what are you concerned about? What are your fears? And they've brought in other farmers to speak to farmers as opposed to trying to do it all themselves. And so unfortunately, short of, you know, buying back that land, it is conversational and education and partnership building and looking for opportunities to bring that back. But there's also work being done under the Aichi targets, which are about conserving nature, and it's the kind of 1% target about keeping nature in cities. I think they have some resources and links to like Canada Target 1, where they have case studies around what places are doing. And the conservation authorities in Ontario, we're doing a lot of work in that space as well.
Somehow from municipal resources for keeping that land for its natural purposes?
Yeah, all that's coming to my mind is where municipalities have been buying houses in floodplains. So I,
no, There are funds. You can get a conservation easement. There are conservation easements.
There's a program in a rural municipality, county Huron. It's the ALUS, where farmers are compensated for the ecological goods and services provided by
trees
and keeping land fallow and that sort of thing. And I know that's a model that's been copied in other places.
Thank you. We've got 8 minutes left, and we've got two questions, so let's...
At 6 o'clock in the evening, my doorbell rang. There was a fireman there. Two things. Move your chemicals up to the next floor and be ready to evacuate. So the city came in, and the NCC, you guys are the cavalry. That's along the bike path. And it was amazing what you did in 48 hours. But where I'm going with this, you saved the day for us. Thank you very much. We really appreciate it. But there was 10-foot screens on one end of the bike path and on the other end. We had amazing volunteers come in that put sandbags in. And then the bikers started to come. Now, I'm a biker. I did the Cornwall ride for MS this year to Cornwall and back. But they would move that sign, go around it, and we had in our neighborhood, we had 48-hour patrols, so 24-hour patrols. So we worked in sequences. So you would ask them, would you mind going down to the lower path? They'd give you the finger or tell you to blank off. And the city workers, they were saying worse things to them. So that's not all of them, but my point is we have to live in that property. We have to get people to come in and help us. We have to get the professionals like the firemen, the engineers. I have a friend in Don Robin. He told me they used to break the tape and come in and take pictures. We had people standing out in front of the sandbags where our house was sandbagged. Husband and wife, the husband's taking a picture of the wife, and then they change places. So the point is, I don't think they really get it. So educational is required that when something like this happens, help make people aware that there's people having to live in this, and they can make it a lot easier by not doing those kind of things. Does that make any sense?
Yeah. It's a very interesting point, which goes to the whole point of the more people understand and more people know, then hopefully situations like that could be avoided, I guess.
Yeah, those human-centered stories, right? If you don't know that human impact and you just see sandbags, it's hard to relate it to somebody's house, somebody's livelihood. So I think the more those stories can get published and get that exact comment into the media, the better.
Thank you. Last question.
The graph of the population explosion as it was going up, there is one physical fact, and that is after that distance in time, it's going to level. Because the people, as they end up having a lift up in their cultural monetary status, there is less and less population. So there is a limit to the amount of population that is going to rise to. So the fear of the whole world being taken over by population is fictional. The ration isn't there. But in your graph, you seem to express it was. And another part is the fact about how the idea of architecture with the, I'm in architecture, the RID and the structure, when you're saying putting in screws, the difficulty between screws and nails, nails bend, screws snap. So the long nail is better in structural strength than the screw, as I've been taught. So answers to the questions?
About the population, it was just describing what we, it's a history of the past population moves so far. So the spike we've seen since mostly the last two centuries, and that has accelerated in the last 50, 60 years, mostly since I was born, population has more than doubled. which hasn't happened in the past at any time. So the United Nations Population Agency or something says it should level off around 9 or 10 billion, which is 1 or 2 billion more, and flatten and then decrease. I agree with you, that's the current projection. But if you also study other animal populations, and the caribous in the north are a good example. There were 1 million in northern Quebec and Labrador. Now they're 10,000. So it can crash also. So that can happen to the human animal population too. Epidemics can happen, catastrophes and unlivable situations due to air pollution and so on and so forth. So I don't know what will happen. Technology can change things. Common sense, I don't believe. It hasn't been so effective so far. Prevention, I don't think it's been very effective neither. So with more catastrophes at some point, maybe we'll find an equilibrium that will make it sustainable for a large amount of people on the earth. But there'll be some stuff, some nasty stuff will happen between now and then.
Thank you. Do you want to answer the question about the screws versus the nails?
Yeah, well, very quickly, if you're in architecture, so if you go to the Simpson Strong Tie catalog, the typical connector that's recommended for wind is the H2.5A. That has a better uplift resistance. And you
that's my favorite one.
Yeah, I know. Everybody likes H2.5A. The builders don't like it. But you have to put 10 nails into it. And that's the most recommended from the wind engineering community. The builders don't like putting all the nails in. So this is a compromise. It doesn't have quite the same uplift resistance, but it's much easier and cheaper to install.
All right. Thank you very much on that point. I'd like to thank all of our speakers. Donc, j'aimerais remercier tous nos présentateurs ce soir. Thank you all for coming out tonight. Our next Urbanism Lab, February 11th, The Geography of Race and Culture. Donc, notre prochain labo d'urbanisme, le 11 février, ici, La Géographie de la Race et de la Culture. Merci, bonne soirée. Thank you.